Bad by Jean Ferris. I knew what my father was going to say before he said it. You're turning out just like your mother. Good, I thought. At least she knew how to have fun. She hadn't sat at home mopping and thinking up new rules to make things hard for everybody else the way he did. You tell me that all the time, I said. My hands on my hips, my heart rate in overdrive, like it's a crime. What if I think it's a good thing? Then you're seriously wrong, he said, standing in front of the door, blocking my exit. And seriously misguided. Don't forget she was drunk when she cracked herself up in the car at 3 in the afternoon with the guy from the next door who should have been at work so he could support his wife and kids. You can't tell me that's a good thing. I was only 4 when she died. All I could remember of her is how she smelled at the jingle of her silver bracelets and the way things felt more exciting when she was around. Even then, I think I understood that she knew what a good time was all about. While my father wouldn't know, one of it came bow-tied and special delivery. Okay, so maybe she overdid it, but she managed to get in a lot of living before she ran out of time. I wonder if she knew how much trouble she left behind. You're not living here tonight, my father said. I know you're going to meet that boy. He's bad news and you know it. I've been telling you that for the last 6 months from that day you met him. If you leave here, you're admitting what you want is to get into trouble. He was right. Ray was bad news. But that was part of his appeal. And I probably would get into trouble. But when I was with Ray, things happened. There was excitement and action, feeling me, proving I was there. At home, at school, when I managed to get there, everything seemed to be in slow motion and muted colors. I felt hollow and barely visible. Ray called it skating when we did that crazy thing, grabbing an old lady's purse when she cut through the park in the late afternoon. How hot wiring a fancy car for a joyride after midnight boosting stuff from stores. Ray liked to take cigarettes. Me? I was so good. I told him I could get away with the sales clerk's pantyhose. I had a drawer full of clothes and jewelry I'd taken but wouldn't wear. It was the skating, not the stuff, that I liked. Let me move this. The one skatey thing I really didn't like was the way Ray sometimes insisted on sex in public places. Quick, up against the wall, in an alley in the daytime, or slow on golf course at night, even when it was cold out. But I knew he'd be in good mood after happy with me, and that made it worth it. You're not Ray's favorite person either, I said to my father. He says your rule book must be a foot thick, just like his skull. Why don't you understand that what I'm trying to do is protect you? I know what a mess somebody like your mother lives behind her, and I don't want your life to be as messy as Dixie Lee's. Dixie Lee, I love my mother's name. It sounded spirited, and lively. I knew it must have been her idea to name me Dallas. Dear old dad would never have thought of something like that. Well, you picked her, I said. Don't blame me. And I'm paying for it, he said, almost inaudibly. I don't care if you are only 16. If you leave this house tonight, I'll take no responsibility for what happens to you next. Great, I said, pushing my way around him to the door. That'd be a relief to us both. I ignored that sick lurch my stomach always took when he said he'll had enough of me. Even if I didn't think he meant it, I'll go meet Ray. We'll do some skating. I'll sleep at Pam's the way I done plenty of other times until he comes down. I'll be okay. Ray was at the cafe where we usually met. Pam, my best friend for the past 2 years, and Sonny, her boyfriend and Ray's best friend, were with him, drinking coffee and working on a big plate of fries. Pam and Sonny had fixed me up with Ray, and since then I finally had a feeling of belonging somewhere, of having my own group. I didn't ever want to be without them. Hey, babe, Ray said to me, snaking his arm around my waist and pulling me into the booth. We figured you were ducking it out with our old man. He dragged me up against him. He was warm and solid, and for that moment, I felt safe. You win. I'm here, ain't I? I said. What's happening? As far as Pam's folks are concerned, Sonny said, his arms around Pam's shoulders. She's babysitting. Too bad your old man's not as easy to fool as they are. A much better liar than Dallas is, Pam said. She looked like a second grader with her cutest short hair cut and her little white blouse. So it was no big job to see why the... could fool her parents whenever she wanted to, but she liked skating as much as I did. Through four different reasons, she got off on how easy it was to fool people, to rip them off, to get them to believe her lies. I made her feel superior. It made me feel alive. We were thinking we might try something different tonight, Ray said. Something like a little skatier. Like what? I still felt breathless, partly from rushing to get there, partly from the showdown with my father. Look, Pam said. She handed her purse across the table. Look inside. I opened it. Next to the wallet, keys, and other junk was a small, shiny silver pistol. I looked up at her, startled. Where you get that? I handed her back at the purse as if it contained a live snake. It's my dad's. He reported it stolen a couple of months ago. But I'm the one that stole it. I figure it might come in handy sometime. You never know. Looks like tonight. That's the night, Sonny said. Why? I asked. What's happening tonight? We're going to get some money, Ray said. You know how you ladies have been wanting to go to the Thim Phun, but we can't. We can't. Get it because they're so tight about IDs? Well, we need to buy us some fake IDs and some hot clothes to go with them. We'll be going to Typhoon in style. Who's going to give us this money? I asked. Who has the most this time of night? Sonny asked. Who? I said. This was the scariest thing I ever been in on. The gun scared me in a way that made my stomach hurt. Liquor stores, they also have security cameras, Ray said. Not to mention guns of their own. It waved his hand dismissively. So they're out. We're after a jiffy spot. They have money and no guns. Are you sure? I asked. You ever notice who works in those places? Kids, old folks, foreigners, people without our smarts. They still have security cameras, I said. Hey, what are you, chicken? Ray asked, drawing away from me. What's with all those objections? I'm not objecting. I insisted. I wanted him next to me again. I'm just trying to use some of those smart I'm supposed to have. Ray laughed and put his arms back around me. Okay, then. There's a way around security cameras and we're already done it. Done what? I asked. First you pick the place, Sonny said. Then you'll create a disturbance. Which Sonny and I did last night, Ray added. We knocked over the whole big Super Bowl display, beer, chips, dips, little footballs, made a real mess. And while Ray and the clerk worked on cleaning it up, Sonny went on. I got up on the counter and smeared Vaseline on the camera's lens. By the time the clerk was back to his post, it was all over and he never knew it happened. Vaseline? I asked. Yeah, blurs the image. But the camera doesn't look tampered with. Pretty slick, huh? Pam grinned. Yeah, Barry, where is this place? Not in our neighborhood, that's for sure, Sonny said. We don't want to run into somebody we might know us. I barely listened to while they talked. I knew I had to go along with them. Whatever they planned, I always did. With them, too, holiness inside me was filled enough. Even if I came back when I was by myself. Well, let's get going, Red said, giving me a push. Adventure is waiting. A fine cold drizzle had started. I shivered and got into Ray's car. Pam and Sonny were in the back seat. We stopped in the parking lot of Jiffy Spots across town. There were two other cars in the lot. And while we sat there, a man came out of the store, got in one of them, and drove away. I'll go in and see what it looked like, Sonny said. After a few minutes, he came out of the Jiffy Spot and got back in the car. Damn it, getting old, he rubbed his arms. Nobody in there except the clerk that must be in this car. Ray put his hand on my thigh. We decided to get to hold the gun. We decided you get to hold the gun. I started and Ray gripped my leg harder. Me? Why me? You seem sunk tonight, babe. Being behind a weapon, I'll wake you up. Think of it as vitamins. He laughed. Vitamins? He said again, that's pretty good. I don't need that, I said. Really, I'm okay. Ray's fingers were hurting me, as I knew there'd be bruises on my skin tomorrow. We don't think you are, he said. I am, I promise, I said. I'm just afraid of guns. All you have to do is hold it, Ray said. There's nothing going to be any need to use it. Then Pam can do that, I said. It's her gun. I wanted to have the fun of it. Pam said, I can't do it again. And other time, the three of them were watching me. It was clear that I had no choice now but to take the gun and appreciate the honor. Okay, I said, give it to me. It was heavier than I thought it would be, and as cold as dead in my hand. The rest of us? Going first, Ray said. We'll be in the back of the store in the case you need help. He pulled me into him and kissed me, pushing his tongue in my mouth. for Lux, he said. Pam, Sunny, Ray got out of the car and went into the Jiffy spot. I sat in the front seat shivering and wondering what would happen if I just opened the door and walked away. I sighed, knowing I never have the guts to do that. I got out of the car. I walk into the Jiffy spot with the gun in my hand and my hand in my jacket pocket. I saw the clerk leaning on the counter over a newspaper. Should I have been able to tell with a one glance at me I was going to do? But he only looked up from his newspaper. Somehow I registered that it was in foreign language, said hello, and went back to his reading. I stopped in front of him and took the gun out of my pocket. He looked up, saw the gun. I swear to God, I thought we were both going to faint. Neither of us could say the word. I don't know how long we might have stood there staring at each other if Mr. Malvern Washington, the night watchman at the building across the street, hadn't forgotten his lunch and came in just then to buy something to eat. I learned this, of course, and also that he played football in high school. High school was a long way back for him, but he kept in good shape. And when he threw himself on me, I was down for the count. None of us, freaked out clerk, the ferocious Mr. Washington, or me, noticed when Ray, Pam, and Sonny slipped away, but by the time an unnecessary number of cup cars showed up and they were gone, and I knew I was taking this fall by myself. I could even hear Pam, all wide-eyed and innocent, telling her father that I must have taken the gun one of those many times I'd been at the house, and her mother sighing and saying that she warned Pam about me, but that Pam was just too trusting, too ready to believe in the good in everyone. And as long as she was the way, there will be people like me to take advantage of her. Okay, this is the end of chapter 1.